Hey, Harvest. We're so glad that you're watching with us online this weekend. We're really, really glad that you are here. So we're about to get started for the service. So why don't you go grab your coffee, get situated. And I just want to tell you about a few things while we have these few minutes. There's a really cool class that's going to be starting here in Rolling Meadows real soon. This class is for all women and all men. It's called How to Study the Bible Seriously. It starts on Wednesday night, October 28th. It's going to be here in the Meadows campus. And it's going to be taught by our very own Dr. Van Lanningham. He's our resident theologian, and I can tell you, I've sat under his teaching. It is phenomenal, and he will undoubtedly help you unlock just some of the mysteries of the Word and just how to study in just to deepen your walk with Christ. So I really think it's a really worthwhile investment. So go on over to harvestnow.info, and you can sign up right there. Well, Harvest Young Adults, I want you to know, I've heard from so many people that you guys had such a great time at your last gathering over at the Barcos in Barrington. And I'm super, super happy for you. And I'm glad to tell you that there's another gathering coming up real soon, not out in Barrington, but here on the Rolling Meadows campus on Thursday night, October 29th. So we know that you guys will have a great time when you come together. You've already proven that. But we also pray that you'll be so refreshed and renewed through some worship and some inspiration from the Word. So it's about time for the service to start right now. And so I just want to say thank you to Pastor Tommy. He's going to bring us another message in this series, Teach Us to Pray. We're so grateful for all you do for us, Tommy. You pour yourself out for us. So would you join me now in worship?
Hey, welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel. We're so glad that you're joining us. We're going to sing some songs of faith to the Lord. God's not done working. He's not done. And so we're going to lift up our faith, lift up our song to the Lord together. Come on.
God of the promise, God of the future, you see beginning and there. God of the rescue, God of the breakthrough, how great is your faithfulness. You're not done yet.
No, you aren't done, God.
No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust. Put a song in my soul. God in the working, God I'm believing, you'll do the impossible.
Yes, you do, God,
and you're not done yet.
No,
no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, your glory come down. Don't hold back. Don't.
Come on, let's sing it out to him.
You're up to something right now.
Go!
Hey, Harvest, we are so glad that you are here with us this weekend watching online, and amen to that song, He's Not Done Yet, for sure. My name is Lynn. I'm from the Elgin campus, and I'm really honored to be your online host this weekend. You know, I'm happy to come to church every single weekend, but I am particularly glad to be here this week. It's been a hard week, to be honest, for a lot of different reasons, and I'm so glad to be able to come here and just be reminded of God's prevailing power and His everlasting love. I pray that you're glad that you joined as well. Well, if you're here for the first time, we just want to give you a very special welcome. We're glad you've landed right here, and we hope that you are glad as well. So whether you're new or whether you've been here for forever, just like me, we would ask that you would just take a second and go ahead and check in. You can do that. There's a little tab at the top of your screen, or you can do that right on your app. Well, I want to tell the students, junior high and high school, that today is a really cool day. It's a special day. You guys are relaunching an in-person ministry tonight. So tonight at 5 o'clock on all the campuses, with the exception of Elgin and the Cathedral, you guys will be meeting at your campus to get together. Elgin, you'll be starting your ministry on Wednesday night, October 21st. And Cathedral, you guys are going to continue online for a little bit. If I could just speak to a second to you students, I know it's really hard to walk into a place where you haven't been for a really long time, or maybe you haven't even been ever. And I just want to encourage you to be brave. Just have some courage and walk in tonight and just trust God. There are leaders, there are students, there are pastors there that really want to make you feel comfortable. It's going to be worth it. All right, well, I have another really cool announcement. This has to do with the Deerfield Road campus. They have a new campus pastor. As of today, Carl Barco is going to be the new campus pastor out there. His lovely wife, Kim, and their wonderful three kids are so excited about jumping into this ministry on this campus. It's Deerfield Road right now, but very rapidly, they're going to change their name to the North Shore campus. They were that a while ago, and we're excited for them to go forward. So Carl and Kim and North Shore folks, we're praying for you and just praying God's blessing to you in this new chapter. I also want to just take a second and say thank you to every single one of you who have been giving of your tithes and your offerings. We appreciate it. And the Lord sees you. We just also want to remind all of you that there are actually four ways you can give here at this church. They're online right now. The ways to give are on your screen. You can give online, you can give through a text, you can give through a mobile app, or you can also just mail in your gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. Again, please know how grateful we are. Would you bow with me now in prayer? Father in heaven, we come before you and we know that you welcome us no matter how we feel. So you're not taken aback at all by some of our fears about this crazy world that's surrounding us right now. And we can come and know that you are the anchor to our souls. We know that you indeed are the one that can calm the waves of the sea. Even the wind and the waves obey you. So we know that you can calm the storms in our own lives. We ask you to do that. And Lord, we also pray a blessing for these people who are giving generously to sustain this ministry. We pray that it blesses them, it will bless you, Lord, and it will bless the ministry of this church. For your glory, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Jesus. 7, it says, everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat against that house and it fell. And great was the fall of it. And when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes. The rock in this scripture is Jesus himself. And he's telling us today that if we put all of our trust and all of our hope in him, we will not be shaken. So where else can we go but to the rock of ages? And I know there's been wind, I know there's been storms, there's been such instability in our lives and in our culture and in our country, but there's been one person that through it all that has never changed, that has not been moved, that has not faltered, and is still in control of it all, and his name is Jesus, Jesus Christ. So we can't build our lives on anyone else or anything else, only on Jesus. And I really believe that Jesus has such an invitation for every single one of us today. For us here right now in this room, and for all of you wherever you're watching right now, Jesus is inviting us to run to him, for he is a refuge for us, a safe place for us, a firm foundation that we can build our lives on, that we can put all of our trust in. And we can put the full weight of our trust and our hope in him. And he's inviting all of us to do that today. And he will prove himself faithful. And he will prove himself trustworthy.
There is no one else for me. crucified to set us free. Now we live to bring him praise. Oh, Jesus.
Yeah. To worship you, God.
No pen, no quill, and no scribing perfect skill with flawless words could capture all you are. No lofty thought, no scholar of this world could grasp an inch of such infinity. Though we cannot comprehend such a mystery, just a glimpse of you revealed is compelling us to see. And holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, worthy, worthy is your name. And all of heaven joins the
John.
Lord, your name is so worthy. Your name is so holy. Is it above every other name? Under heaven and on earth, Lord. We lift high the name of Jesus Christ in this building, in our homes, whatever city, state, or country we might be watching in. Lord, we join as one to exalt your Son, Jesus Christ. Might you reignite the wonder and the passion that we have for him. As Pastor Tommy comes forward, might we be open to hear what you have for us. Might you soften our hearts. Help us to be more like you. We pray that in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, hey, church, it's good to be with you today. Listen, before we jump in, I want to let you know about something that's coming up. It's actually starting this Monday, and it's going to be a prayer guide for every day of the week. This is what we're calling it. We're calling it 21 Days of Prayer, and we're calling our church to rally behind this next 21 days and pray together as a church, coming together and praying. And there's a lot going on in our world. There's the election, there is COVID, there are people who are hurting, and we need to be coming together as a church and pray. And so that's what this is, the next 21 days, which is gonna take us all the way through the end of election week up until the next series. We're going to pray together, and we're gonna have a guide for you every single day of the week, and you can find it on our website at harvestbiblechapel.org/teach-us-to-pray. It's also gonna be on social media. So let's get together, church. Let's pray for the next 21 days, starting Monday. And I believe that God is going to do a great work in us and through us as we seek him in prayer. Well, listen, we're gonna be talking about a pretty difficult, hard topic today. And I have found in my research over the past couple of weeks that many people believe many different things about this topic. And the topic, of course, for us today is forgiveness, as we are in Matthew chapter 6, verse 12. And what a topic for us to be in a world that is consumed with us versus them, where offense is found around every corner, where we have become more easily offendable, where we have a lack of empathy and emotion towards one another. In fact, really the only emotion that we feel towards each other is anger, and we are becoming more and more distant from one another. We have set up in our camps, and we have decided that we good, everyone else bad, and everything that the other camp says hurts us, it wounds us, it offends us. But listen, more importantly than any of that, we live in a world that is still full of sinful people who sin against others. What a time to navigate. Certainly not easy, not easy at all. But thankfully, we have the Word of God. We have God's Word, and if we place God's Word in the rightful place in our lives, which is the highest earthly authority that we have, then we have a clear guide on how to navigate. Clear. How do we navigate? It's clear. We have the Bible. We have the scriptures. And so listen, down with us versus them mentality, and we're moving towards us and them. It's the title of our message today, Us and Them. We're going to be Matthew chapter 6, verse 12. And we are going to see how Jesus is teaching us to pray on this topic. And we're also going to dive deep into the topic of forgiveness itself, especially given the state of our world. This is an incredibly important and much needed walk through forgiveness. So teach us to pray, Lord. Look at Matthew chapter 6, verse 12. It says, "And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors." And forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. We're gonna break this up into two sections. And the first section is this: God forgives us, and forgive us our debts. God forgives us, and forgive us our debts is the first part of that passage. This here is the second petition that we see that we're asking the Lord in this prayer. Last week, if you remember, it was provision from the Lord. Give us this day our daily bread. Lord, sustain me for today. And now, forgive us our debts. The first word there is and. and forgive us our debts. This is a continuation from the first petition. They are linked together. So Lord, not only give us this day our daily bread, Lord, sustain me for this day, but also this, forgive us our debts. Now, Matthew uses the word debt here in the passage, whereas in Luke 11, it uses the word sin. It says, forgive us our sins. Now, I just want to make this super clear. This isn't talking about financial debts that we have incurred, okay? We're not asking God to forgive us our mortgage, okay? We're asking him to forgive us our debts. This is a metaphor for debt incurred by sin. So it's saying essentially the same thing as Luke 11, but in a different way. And I think a good note about this here is that this is really bringing out the reality of sin so that we can see it clearly. You see, when we sin, we incur a debt to God. In the same way that someone who commits a crime incurs a debt to society, and then the way that they pay off that debt is that they spend time in prison. In God's economy, the debt we incur through sin would require an eternity to pay off, thus making it impossible to pay it off ourselves, which dives headfirst into our need for a savior. We cannot pay the debt that we owe. We cannot pay the debt that we owe. And so God, in his love for us, sent his son, Jesus Christ, the one who is teaching us to pray right here in Matthew 6, to live the perfect life that we could never live and to die a death on the cross in our place for our sin. When we believe in Jesus Christ as Savior, as the one who took our place on the cross for our sin, as the spotless Lamb of God who rose again, defeating sin and death, we are saved. Through grace alone, by faith alone. And in that moment of salvation, we are confessing to God our need for Jesus as our Savior. We are confessing our sin to him, and he forgives us the debt that we owe, past, present, and future. This is something called justification. It's called justification. And justification is the once and for all declaration by God that you are righteous in his sight. Because of what Jesus has done on the cross, because of what he has done for you, you have been justified. Justification, once and for all declared by God that you are righteous in his sight. When he looks at you, he sees you as righteous. Not because of how you acted or because of how you act, but because of what Jesus has done for you. Past, present, and future, justified, forgiven. At the moment of salvation, how amazing is that? How amazing is that? May we never forget the wonders of God's grace towards us. May we never forget the miracle of his mercy towards us. May we never forget the satisfaction of our souls that salvation brings. That no matter the depth of our sin, no matter the messiness of our past, no matter our total absolute depravity, that we can come to God through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and be forgiven. Forgiven. It's amazing. It's amazing. But it comes with, I think, a question as we think about that being justified once and for all, forgiven past, present, and future. And the question I think that comes with that is, why do I need to continually ask God for forgiveness? If I have been justified, if God has forgiven me past, present, and future, why do I continually need to come and ask God for forgiveness as Jesus is teaching us to pray right here? This is a big tension in the Christian life. And listen, when it's not applied correctly, it can lead to wrong thinking. It can lead to thinking like, I've been saved by grace so I can live like hell. I'm forgiven so I can keep on sinning. God's forgiven my future sins already. I can keep on going. No worries in my mind. Wrong thinking. That is cheap forgiveness. That is hyper grace. That's wrong thinking. Or it could lead to the inverse. I don't believe that I'm justified once and for all. I can lose my salvation. If I miss this even once, if I miss this, every time I sin, I can go from being saved to not saved. And only when I ask for forgiveness am I saved again. Also wrong thinking. That's works salvation. That depends way too much on me. And so here are three things that help me think about this right theologically. Here's the first thing. Space and time. Space and time. These are really important things when we're talking about God, his viewpoint versus our viewpoint. You see, God is outside of space and time. God is outside of space and time. So for him to say that we are justified past, present, future is right because he sees our future like it's an open book. Whereas we don't know what our future is, and as we live, we will sin. And when we do, God's word tells us that we need to return to God in confession, which is agreeing with God about my sin, and repentance, which is changing my mind about that sin and turning from it. This is our sanctification being lived out in our lives, moment to moment, in time, our sanctification being made lived out, being made holy as he is holy. Maybe you need a visual. This always helps me. And so here's your life. It has a beginning. It has an end right here. And you go through life and you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Believe in him for the forgiveness of your sin. Wherever that moment takes place in your life. But then after that moment, you're going to sin quite a bit more as you live. We are imperfect. And so when God is looking at this outside of space and time, like this right here, he can see all of it. He can see the beginning. He can see the end. It's an open book to him. And he has declared at salvation, we are justified. We are forgiven, past, present, future. But for us, it's a little bit differently. We live on the line. And so we don't see the full picture. We go day to day into, and then we sin. And we need to come back to God, and we need to ask him for forgiveness. We need to confess our sin to him. So that's the first thing. It's helpful to think about that. God is outside of space and time. Here's some other helpful things. Positional forgiveness. Positional forgiveness. This is what happens at that moment of salvation. Due to the forgiveness and justification given to us by God at the moment of salvation, our position changes. Some people call this judicial forgiveness. Our position changes. We go from death to life, from sinner to saint, from guilty to not guilty, from orphan to adopted by God. We are in his family now. Our position changes forever. This is what gives us the assurance of our salvation. This is what gives us confidence to know that we are saved. And this is what gives us the ability to enjoy fellowship with God. Positional forgiveness. And then there's this. Relational forgiveness. Relational forgiveness doesn't change our position. It changes our enjoyment of that position and our fellowship with God. This is the restoration of relationship with God. I want you to think about it maybe this way. It helps me. Think about a time that you've wronged your parents, right? Maybe you sinned against them, you disobeyed them, you said something hurtful to them, you did something hurtful to them. In that moment when you sinned against them, did you cease to become a part of the family? Did they cease to become your mom and dad? Did you cease to become their child? No. No, the relationship was fractured and needed to be repaired, but your position in the family never changes. It can never change. Your dad will always be your dad. Your mom will always be your mom. You will always be their child. Now, if that's true of sinful parents, how much more true is that of our perfect heavenly Father? That's relational forgiveness. This is the forgiveness Jesus is teaching us to pray right here. He's teaching us to pray relational forgiveness with God our Father. Look at the first words of the prayer. It starts off with our Father in heaven. This isn't the prayer of an unbeliever. This is the prayer of somebody who's already in God's family. This is relational forgiveness we are praying for. We're praying for God to forgive us, to cleanse us of our sin in the same way as John 13, where Jesus is washing the feet of the disciples. And Peter is hesitant at first. I love Peter. Peter's so great. He's hesitant at first. He's like, Lord, Lord, listen, you're the Lord. My feet are dirty. What are you doing? You're not gonna touch my feet. You're not gonna wash my feet. And Jesus is like, listen, if you don't let me do this, you have no share with me. And Peter's like, okay, wash all of me, all right? Not just my feet, Lord, but everything else too. And Jesus is like, calm down, Peter. Calm down. But Jesus then makes a very important distinction for us. Very important. He says, the one who is bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. The one who is bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. He's saying, Peter, you have already been bathed, saved. You have already been saved. You have already been bathed, but you need your feet clean. You need your feet washed. When we live the Christian life, we continue on and we will sin. We will get our feet dirty. And when we do, we need to come to the Lord and we need to ask for forgiveness and be cleansed of those dirty feet. Daily, this should be our prayer. We should be praying this daily. Jesus is teaching us this. Forgive us our debts. Go to the Lord. Ask for forgiveness. Lord, forgive me my debts to you. Maybe you're in the place where you've never trusted in Jesus as your Savior, never believed in him as the one who came and died for your sin and rose again. And maybe the prayer that you need to pray right now isn't the relational prayer. It's the positional prayer. And maybe you're sitting there right now, how is that possible, Pastor Tommy? How could that possible? Do you know what I've done in my past? Do you know how much I've sinned? Do you know what I've done to people? Listen to me, no matter your past, no matter what you've done, God is standing there with open arms. If you believe in the name of Jesus Christ, if you believe that Jesus came and died for your sin and rose again, if you believe in him for the forgiveness of your sin, you will be saved. You can have that now. Your position can change from guilty to not guilty, from orphan to child of God. Maybe that's the prayer that you need to pray. Or maybe you need to pray this exactly how Jesus is teaching us relationally. You have been sinning and you haven't been coming to the Lord asking him to forgive you. It's been some time, weeks, maybe months, maybe longer since you've come to the Lord and asked him to forgive you for your sin. You've been walking around with dirty feet and they only seem to be getting dirtier and you have been distanced from the Lord. You have felt distant from the Lord. You haven't felt the joy of his fellowship, the nearness of him. Pray, forgive us our debts, restore our relationship. God, I want the enjoyment that comes with fellowship with you. He is ready and he is willing. All we need to do is come and ask. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Our prayer, God, forgive us. And listen, then God forgives us. God, forgive us, then God forgives us. That's the first part. God forgives us. And then here's the second part of our scripture today. We forgive them. We forgive them as we also have forgiven our debtors. So Jesus is teaching us to pray that God would forgive us, restore us, cleanse us, and that we would forgive those who have sinned against us. Praying, God, forgive us, and we forgive them. I want us to note the way that this verse is structured. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. These are linked together. Here's an important thing for you. Forgiven people forgive people. Forgiven people forgive people. And we see that even more clear in verse 14 and 15, which we're gonna get to in a couple of minutes. And so not only are these two things linked, but it seems that forgiveness of others is a prerequisite for receiving forgiveness from God. That before we ask for forgiveness from God, and remember we're talking about relational forgiveness, we have forgiven those in our lives. Before we seek forgiveness for our own sin, we have already forgiven those who have sinned against us. Why? Why is this important? Here's why. Because if we came to God to ask for forgiveness and are unwilling to forgive those who have sinned against us, what does that make us? What does that make us, church? It makes us hypocrites. It makes us hypocrites. Asking God for something that we are unwilling to give to others, that is being a hypocrite. God isn't going to honor that. And in fact, God tells us throughout his word that he will measure us in the way that we measure others. Luke 6 says, "Forgive and you will be forgiven. Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over will be put into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you." If we are not forgiving others, how do you think God is going to measure that towards us? So many Christians in this world are missing this right here. They are unwilling to forgive. Maybe they've heard somewhere that they don't need to forgive, or that the offense was just too much. I can't forgive that person. I can't. Do you know what they said to me? Do you know what they did to me? They sinned against me. How could I possibly forgive them? Or maybe it's something we just think differently. We're never gonna see eye to eye. What's the point? What is the point in me forgiving them? What's the point? It's never gonna work. There is so much wrong thinking about forgiveness amongst Christians. So let's talk about what forgiveness of others isn't and what it is. This is not an exhaustive list. This is just a couple of the main points that I wanna make sure that we understand as we're walking through this. Let's start with what it isn't. Forgiveness, what it isn't. Forgiving doesn't mean forgetting. Forgiving does not mean forgetting. We don't forget the offense when we forgive. That would be irresponsible of us. Now there's a distinction that needs to be made, okay? We don't keep a record of the wrongdoing. We don't hold it over people. We don't use that to batter them. Forgiving doesn't mean forgetting. We use that experience to help us move forward with people, learning from, maybe we need to set some boundaries here, maybe we need to do something different in the relationship so that this doesn't happen again. Forgiving does not mean forgetting. Here's another thing. Forgiving doesn't mean you don't long for justice. Forgiving doesn't mean you don't long for justice. But what it is it's saying, God, not my justice. I'm handing this offense, I'm taking this offense, and Lord, I am giving it to you, the one who has perfect justice. I'm giving it to you. It's not that I'm not longing for justice. I'm removing my justice and I'm giving it to God. I'm giving it over to him and to his justice. Forgiving doesn't mean that you're a doormat. It doesn't mean that you're a doormat. For you to just lie down and have this person continually sin and sin and sin and just walk over you as you passively lay there. That's not what forgiving is. We need to be responsible. When someone commits an offense towards me, we need to be safe when someone commits an offense towards me. I need to put boundaries up. That relationship may never look the same. That relationship may never go back to the place that it was because I need to put boundaries up. I'm not gonna make it easy for them to sin against me. Forgiving doesn't mean you're a doormat. So what does it mean? What is forgiveness? Well, forgiving is canceling the debt. It's canceling the debt. It's pardoning the offense. It's saying, I am not going to hold this against you anymore. I am freeing you from my wrath. I'm not going to torture you. I'm not going to bring this up. I am not going to hold this over you for the rest of your life. I am canceling the debt in the same way that Jesus does that to us when we ask for forgiveness. He cancels our debt, separates it as far as the east is from the west. That's what we're doing with others. We're canceling the debt. You owe me nothing. I'm not trying to grab something from you anymore. It's forgiving. Forgiving is canceling the debt. Forgiving is pursuing restoration. Forgiving is pursuing restoration. True forgiveness acts in love towards one another. God's heart is reconciliation. God's heart is restoration. God's heart is redemption. And so I think it needs to be noted here that restoration, reconciliation takes two people, but we should be pursuing restoration. We should be pursuing that because God has asked us to. As it is within your power, be at peace with all men. As it is within my power, I am going to be at peace with people. I'm going to pursue restoration. Now, they might not accept that. They might not agree with that. They might not see that the same as me. And they might refuse that restoration. And that's okay, because you have done what God has placed on your heart to go and do. The rest is in their court. Forgiving is pursuing restoration. Here's another thing. Forgiving is a miracle. Forgiving is a miracle. It is the work of the Holy Spirit within me. Listen, you cannot forgive on your own strength. That doesn't work. Forgiving is a miracle. It is a miracle that is happening inside of my heart. I have been wounded. I have been hurt. An offense has happened. But because of what Jesus Christ has done for me, because of the forgiveness that I have from God, because the Holy Spirit lives in me, this miracle can take place in my heart and I can forgive others. It's a miracle. And then finally this, forgiving is a process. It is rarely a one moment, like one climactic moment in time. Sure, it might start there, but it is a process. It is a process. Forgiving is a process. It starts, though, with saying, I choose to forgive. I'm choosing forgiveness. The process starts there. And so, what about your life? Are you forgiving? Just take a moment. Do an inventory. Are you forgiving others as God has forgiven you? Or are you walking around with unforgiveness? Because see, when we walk around with unforgiveness, a couple of things happen. I'm calling it bear traps and muddy shoes. Bear traps and muddy shoes. Unforgiveness is this trap that we too often find ourselves putting our hand towards. And when we choose not to forgive, when we choose unforgiveness, when we say, I am not going to forgive, I am unwilling to forgive this person, boom, the trap snaps. We're trapped. I put my hand into the trap of unforgiveness. This hurts. That really hurt. I can't stop thinking about this. Look at it. It's weighing me down. It's heavy. I'm becoming bitter. I can't really function anymore because I'm so focused on the pain that happened here, on the thing that happened here, on the person that happened here. I'm stuck. I'm trapped. I become bitter, and I become angry, and I become unloving. I get stuck in the bear trap of unforgiveness because I won't forgive others. Not only this, though, there's another thing that happens when I'm not forgiving. Forgiving others is the prerequisite to being relationally forgiven by God. And so not only do I have this bear trap, not only am I trapped, not only does this hurt, but now I'm getting dirty feet. I'm stepping in the mud. I'm sinning. And when I come to God and I'm asking Him, forgive me my debts, my feet aren't being cleaned. They're muddy. They're disgusting. And I'm stuck, and my feet are getting heavy. The more mud is put on them, and it's getting harder to move towards the things that God has for me. Look at me. This is the unforgiving life right here. Does this look like joy? This is miserable. This is miserable. There isn't joy here. The root of bitterness is inside of me. I'm stuck in the trap of unforgiveness. My feet are getting dirty. There's no cleansing happening. Listen, God's word is clear. It is clear to us that we need to be forgiving others. When we let go of the trap, He cleans our feet. Take that bear trap off your hand, and I will clean your shoes. Finally, let's take a look at verse 14 and 15. Chapter 6, still verse 14 and 15. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. I don't want to belabor this point. We've talked about that at length at this point. But I do want to just go briefly through a couple of things, because I think when we read that, sometimes we can make some conclusions that maybe not aren't necessarily true. And so I want to walk through what it doesn't mean, what it may mean, and what it for sure means. So let's start with what it doesn't mean. It does not mean that God's positional forgiveness of me is based on or predicated on my forgiveness of others. It cannot mean that. It cannot mean that. That flies in the face of the rest of Scripture, that salvation and with it forgiveness is through grace alone, by faith alone, not of works, that none may boast. If God only forgives me if I forgive others, that's works. My works is forgiving others, and by my works, I am forgiven. Wrong. This is not talking about positional forgiveness, salvation. It's not talking about that. My position in God's family cannot be moved. That's what it doesn't mean. Here's what it may mean, is that this is an evidence of salvation. That forgiven people forgive people. That forgiving others is an evidence of a life that has been forgiven by God. If I am continually in a place of unforgiveness towards others, refusing outright to forgive, I need to check myself. Do I really understand the gospel? Do I really have a real thing going on with God? I may. And I may need to be doing some work with the Lord. God needs to do a work in me, but also I may not. And I need God to do some work in me. That's what it may mean. And here's for sure what it means. This is relational forgiveness. That things won't be good relationally between me and God until I forgive others. I will not experience the joy that comes from fellowship with God. I will not feel the closeness of the Lord because I have put this barrier between us. I will not feel the freedom that God has for me. I will not be effective for the kingdom of God because I have a bear trap and muddy shoes. So how do I take care of this? How do I take care of it? Here's the first thing. Bring it to God. Bring it to God. God, I am struggling with forgiving this person. They have wronged me, you know, Lord. I need you to do a work in my heart of forgiveness towards this person. I know that it's wrong not to forgive them, but Lord, I need your help. Bring it to God. Here's the second thing. This is hard. Bring it to the person. Bring it to the person. Matthew 18 tells us, if your brother has sinned against you, go to him. Bring it to the person. Now, a lot of us avoid this. Because it's conflict, and a lot of us like to avoid conflict, but bringing this to the person, reasoning with them, telling them how this made you feel, maybe God in that moment is going to start the process of forgiveness in your heart. Maybe you two can reconcile together there, because not talking about fringe things, but generally, when you go to someone who has maybe wronged you or sinned against you, sometimes you have done something to them and there's conflict in the relationship, and you two can come together and forgive one another and reconcile. Bring it to the person. But maybe that person didn't see that, didn't agree with that, flat out just rejected your offer of coming together. Here's what you do. Bring it back to God. Bring it back to God. God, that didn't go well, and Lord, I'm coming to you. I need you to do a work still in my heart. Help me, Lord. I choose forgiveness. Help my heart. And we are in a world where it's okay. It's okay to have the mindset of us versus them. God is calling us to something greater. He's calling us to us and them. God forgives us and we forgive them. We can't do this without God. This is a supernatural miracle that is taking place in our hearts. And listen, we need the forgiveness of the Lord and we need to forgive others. So let's stop walking around with bear traps and muddy shoes. Let us be a forgiving people so that we can come to the Father for fresh cleansing every day. Lord, help me to forgive others their debts. And Lord, forgive me mine. Teach us to pray, Lord. The band is gonna sing over us. I just wanna take a second. Maybe you need to do some work with the Lord right now. Maybe you have been harboring unforgiveness. It has turned you bitter. You stuck your hand in the trap and you've been carrying that trap for a long time. You're wearing the bear trap and you're wearing muddy shoes. Listen, take this time right now. Talk to God. God, I don't want to carry these things anymore. I want to let go of the bitterness, the consuming nature of it. Help me to get my hand out of the trap. And Lord, would you wash my feet? Would you cleanse me? I want to feel close to you. I want to feel the joy of my salvation and fellowship with you. Listen, maybe you need to bring that to him right now. I would encourage you to do that. Take this time, right now, in this moment, in this space, talk to God. Cry out to God. Lord, forgive us our debts and help us to forgive others. Help us, God.
Sin runs deep.
Lord, we need you. Help us, Lord. Help us to let go of the bear trap. We need your help. We need the miracle to take place in our hearts. And God, we come before you and we ask that you forgive us our debts. Lord, continue to teach us to pray. It's been awesome worshiping together, hearing from the Lord through his word. Hope you have a wonderful week. You are loved.